It is day, hi there, it's day 13 of Reinvent Your Career in 30 Day Challenge. And today we're going to talk more about LinkedIn. This is the second day that we're going to talk about LinkedIn. And today we're going to talk about how you create your personal, your professional profile on LinkedIn. The key thing is LinkedIn has multiple plans. You don't need to pay anything. Your LinkedIn profile is free. And about 60% of people around the world have a free profile. So you can have one too. So before you get into anything else, just set up a free profile. When you do, it will take your name and it will assign you a URL, which is in the navigation bar. One of the things you want to do is personalize that with your name that you want, because it'll start with the name that you entered and then it'll put about six or seven digits behind it, capital letters and numbers, and you don't need that. And if there are other people who have your name, then you add a qualifier. You can add your middle name, you could add hyphens between your first name, middle initial, last name. You could add a degree like a PMP or an MBA or RN or PhD, whatever it is, so that you have a unique URL for LinkedIn that is identified and that matches your professional name. Well, a couple of days ago, we talked about building your professional name. You should have your LinkedIn page with a similar professional name, because you want your resume, your LinkedIn profile, your email address, any websites to all have this consistent brand name. You are a brand, and your name has to be consistent across all of your platforms. Very important that you add a photo. If you have a photo, you get 14 times more views and something like 30 times more in-mails or contacts. Photos are really important. And don't just take a photo that you took in the backyard and crop other people out of it. You want a professional studio photo. It's very important people don't let you put in a photo on your resume because it's considered unfair hiring practices. But you can put a photo on your LinkedIn page, and that's the one thing that the people will spend the most time is going to be looking at your photo. So it's really important you have a professional studio photo. You can go to any like Target, you can go to Walmart, call them up and tell them you want a professional corporate or resume photo. You don't want the package with the, the little wallet things and all that. No, you don't want all the photo packages. You just want a digital photo that they're going to either give to you on a flash drive or on a CD, or they're going to upload and you're going to be able to download it from some kind of a site. So you want a professional photo in a suit in your professional attire, and they're going to give you background choices. You might want to have one photo with light background, another with a dark background, but generally you want a headshot. While you're doing the photo shoot, think of all the uses that you're going to have for your photo in the future, and you might want to have one from your abdomen up, so you might want to have a larger one that you can use for other purposes, but you want a good studio photo with a white or light or neutral background. Very important. You want to crop it so you see a, let me see right here, about how much you see of me, starting with like collarbones to a couple inches above my head. You don't want it squished in so your head is cut off, and you don't want it way back here so you're seeing your tummy. You want a nice cameo of your face, taking up almost the whole image, round image in your LinkedIn profile. Then you have to write a headline, and the headline should be your branding statement. It is important keywords. You have 120 characters. So you want to talk about, and these are going to be search terms that a recruiter is going to search for. So you want to talk about your what you do for people, your profession, and it can be in, doesn't need to be a sentence. It can be in little snippets of information. It could be a senior leader in HR and administration. And then you can have some bars, and then you can talk PMP slash MBA, certified SHRM, whatever it is that you want, some key terms that somebody who would be looking for someone like you is going to enter into a search engine and they're going to find you. So you have 120 characters. So use them very wisely. Do not put unemployed looking for work. Do not put self-motivated and all that soft skills. Tell exactly what your career, your profession, your certifications, list hard skills that they're going to be able to search for you on. And they're going to tell you in just those 120 characters if this is the right person for them or not. Then you want an about section. The about section is 2,000 characters. And Some people can use a narrative style. I think remember you're looking at that search engine. You're looking for things that are going, and you want your LinkedIn page to mirror your resume whenever possible. So you're going to restate your career objective, talking, saying what you do. I help companies do this, or I help my employer. I help IBM do this, this, and this. And you talk about the achievements that you can make for the employer. Talk to the employer who's looking for you and tell them what I can do for you, Mr. Employer. I can drive marketing excellence, new product development, da, 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 to generate new revenue, maintain customers, grow profitability, and innovate new products and programs. So talk to the employer who's looking at this and tell him what you can do for him. And you have 2,000 characters, so that's a one or two long, you know, good-sized paragraphs. And people don't read long paragraphs, so cut every paragraph up into one, two, or three sentences so it's easy to kind of go from paragraph to paragraph. I've seen, you know, about sections that long, you can't read it. So make sure you cut it into small paragraphs and that you have a summary of credentials. Remember the resume, we talked about building a summary of credentials, your bulleted list of hard data. Well, just copy that right over into your about section so that all those keywords and key skills are there. Because remember, recruiters only spending a few seconds looking at it. They need to find all the information easy to find. The next section is generally your employment section. And there you're going to list employers and you're going to put in dates. LinkedIn prompts you to put in the month and the year. I personally don't like the year, the month, unless it's relatively recent. If you're a new college grad, I've got 35 years of work experience. I can't remember when Johnson and what day I started to work, or month I started to work for Johnson & Johnson 30 years ago. It's like, and when you're writing a resume, you want to eliminate as much as you can so the important stuff stands out. You don't want a lot of information. So I personally, when I write resumes, I like to take off the months. It's just more data. It's more words. It's confusing. You know, if I'm looking at somebody with 10 years, what did you do 10 years ago? I don't care what month it was. I don't care if there was a 3-month void while you were doing something, you know, just talk to me about the big achievements. And then you want to write a short description of the company. And then you want to talk about the same things you talked about in your resume, which is your achievements. And you want to quantify them with a dollar, a number, or a percentage. So don't talk about all the responsibilities and the activities and the roles that you did. What did you achieve? I want to see that you're an achievement-oriented professional. You get things done. Tell me what you've done and achieved. And then in an interview, I'm going to ask you, gee, you grew sales 200% in 6 months. How did you do that? And then you talk about your leadership and your skills and what you did and the tasks and the activities. But these achievements, these quantified achievements, are the hook that are going to get you the interview so the guy can say, now tell me, how did you do that? And that's what you want in your resume. Remember, you've got 7.7 seconds to be seen by a recruiter in a resume. That's about the same amount of time they're going to give you. LinkedIn, maybe a little bit more, but use your time meaningfully. The next section is, and eliminate, make sure the jobs that are on your LinkedIn match the jobs that are on your resume. You're telling a story about what you can do for me, the employer. Okay, so if at some point you washed cars during the summer or you took a part-time job and you're laid off, I don't want to know that unless it builds to the story of what you can do for me. Often people have, you know, all sorts of strange jobs. You know, you can say multiple positions in this field while working my way through undergrad and graduate school. And you can just list them, you know, while you're in school. Who cares? I was a cocktail waitress 40 years ago. Does anybody care? Does that matter in my career? So leave all that stuff off. And put in the same things that are on your resume, the important things that build to this story that say, I'm an accomplished professional, I can do this for you, and here's the background and the experiences I have to do that. As you go, some people say, how far back? As far back as it's relevant. If you have relevant skills from 20 years ago, list those relevant skills. They can be in a summary job. I'm working with a man right now. He's had 20 years leadership in a big company that we all know. And 25 years ago, he was a group product manager for Coca-Cola, for Diet Coke or something. let's list that. Now, we don't have to go through what you did 20 years ago, but the fact that you held that role with that title in a premier global company, that's important. Don't leave it off your resume. I actually, when I'm writing the resume, I'm focusing on those 20 years that he had huge accomplishments for this well-known company. But then we're going to list other, you know, prior employment. And he had several prestigious senior level positions in CPG marketing, consumer packaged goods marketing, which is not the industry he's in now. But list that. That is impressive, not only what you've done now, but all this prior stuff that builds your story. I was working with a lady once, and she had been a nurse many years ago. And so she is teaching nursing administration skills at a university. And she wants, she's got these credentials, but it was 20 years ago, she left it off her resume, the fact that she was a nurse for 20 years. Well, if you're teaching nursing and you want a job in the medical field, all you're doing is saying, I've been a part-time college professor. That's wonderful. You train people. But what are your core credentials in the field? It was that nursing stuff that she took off the resume because somebody said, oh, don't put anything that's over 10 years. Well, that was a core competency that qualifies her for the job that she's looking for. So look at it. Is the employer who's going to hire me interested? Is that data relevant? And then you want to make sure the same listings are match your resume and your LinkedIn page, that they have to match almost exclusively. One of the differences in resumes, you talk an impartial third person, led, generated, etc., managed so-and-so. In LinkedIn, you can talk in first person. So you can talk in a more conversational tone than you would in a resume. So you can do that. Then there's, as you go down, you can add basic skills. And if it doesn't pop up a listing of skills, and you can go up in the menu, and there's a little pull-down menu at the top of your LinkedIn profile, we can pull it down and you can add sections. And you want to make sure you add skills, endorsements, and you want to add recommendations. Now, they're almost down underneath your employment, and you want to list at least 5 skills that are relevant to your field, 10, whatever you want. And then when people visit your profile, they're going to, LinkedIn is going to pop up, people who are your connections, LinkedIn is going to pop up and say, how would you, which of these best typifies Diane? And they're going to leave 3 or 4 skills that I've put there. And then the people who know, you're going to say, oh, she's in product marketing. Oh, she's a teacher. Oh, human resources, whatever. And then that's going to build up, and you want to have, they have a maximum of 99 skills endorsements. The goal is 99 plus, but you should have at least 30 or 40 or 50. So if you're a professional and you don't have any skills endorsement, who's going to believe that you're credible? Right after that is recommendations. And these are where people will write a letter of recommendation, a sentence of recommendation. It's not like, you know, to whom it may concern, you know, letter, et cetera. But it is a couple of sentences talking about how you've worked together. It gives you the option when you pull it down the menu of, you know, Diane was my, you know, who John is writing. I'm asking John to write a resume. John was my boss, a supervisor, a customer, a peer. We worked together, you know, whatever. It gives you the opportunity to say what your role relationship was. And then you want to ask for recommendations, and you want to give recommendations. There's the one for, you know, received and given. And you want both of those because those are important LinkedIn metrics. And LinkedIn's algorithm of who they show you your profile to and how often, et cetera, is based on this big complicated algorithm that nobody knows and keeps changing. But part of it is external links. And links to those recommendations are important external links, and they count heavily in your algorithm of whether you're going to be showcased or not. So you want to give and get endorsements. The easiest way to get endorsements is to endorse somebody else, and then they're going to come to you and say, oh, thank you so much. What can I do for you? And you could say, oh, I'd love to have you give me an endorsement. Or there's a little pencil icon, and you click on it, and then you can go through your connections, and you can then send somebody a little invite saying, would you write me a recommendation? Now, don't use their default text, which is, would you write me a recommendation? Use a default text that simplifies the role and say, would you take just a moment or two of your time, click this link, and write a sentence, 2 or 3, about how we've worked together in the past. because people are going to put it off because they're going to think, oh, I've got to do a letter of recommendation and it's going to be so much work. When did she work for me? And I can't remember what was her title and what were the, you know, no, you don't have to do that. You just say, hey, Diane was a superb professional. She worked for me for 3 years. I would hire her back in an instant. I found her to be this, 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 this. Great professional. Boom. You want 3 sentences from people and you want at least 15 of them. You should be shooting for 15. You need to give 15 recommendations and you should receive 15 recommendations as your goal. And then it's very important that you add contacts. When you go over to the, I think it's people section or connections or something like that. And they'll give you an option and it'll, sometimes it'll pop up saying, should you want to build your profile? You want to have at least 501 connections, first connections on your LinkedIn page, because they will not show your resume to or your profile to recruiters until you have at least 501. You have to be active and engaged in the LinkedIn community. So you're going to pop up an area and it says, would you like to add connections? You say yes. And then it'll ask to sync your email address or your contact database, and it can be Gmail, it can be different email programs, and they actually sync. So you say yes, you give them permission, they go into your database of contacts and they identify every email address that's on their contact with a person that's on LinkedIn, and then they say, would you like to invite these 387 people? And you go yes, click all, and then you can write a little note, please do that, or it just defaults and invites people to connect with you. Now, a lot of people don't check their pages every month. And so if some people are in there every day and they'll respond right away. Some people may not see that invitation for weeks or months. So do it now and start building your connections and don't stop until you have at least 501, because that makes you an active person in LinkedIn. There are other things that you can do. Make sure you add articles and posts, you comment, you engage in the community. I talk about that more inside the challenge. So make sure you go to www.reinventyourcareerin30days.com, which is where the challenge is housed. There are 30 days. There are 30 challenges. When you first sign up for account, you'll be taken to day one. If you've been with me all along, you will see day 13 and the content that we have here on day 13. Inside the challenge, you're going to get a video that walks you step by step through kind of what we've done, but it's going to show you actually with the images of where you click and what you do and you know, the pull down menus, etc. But also, I am giving you a downloadable guide on how to format your LinkedIn page, and that's going to show you how many characters, how many spaces, how big the images can be, what size it can be. So it's a handy formatting guide that will help you format your LinkedIn page correctly. When you've done all of that, I encourage you to go to my homepage, www.dianehuth.com, because I've got lots more free gifts for you there. This is Diane, the career coach, and I'm wishing you career success. I will see you inside the challenge. Click and let's go into the challenge. Bye-bye.